it's trying to bring the universal operating system for desktops and more powerful machines right the way down to the level. But it is still Debian. And everything involved in it is still doing it with the Debian systems. We're going to cover how MDebian works and a little history of how long the project's been going. It's not something that's happened suddenly, as well as the challenges that we face in trying to make Debian much, much smaller, as well as make it flexible enough to go onto these small devices. The history of the project has meant that we have tried a number of different ways of doing things, and over time we have learned lessons from one method and we've found the benefits of a different way of doing it, and the current method is a composite of previous ways of doing things, trying to get the best out of each of the previous ways of trying to do embedded work with Debian type packages and trying to get around some of the limitations of other ways of doing it that perhaps Open Embedded or GPE would do at the moment, or be in other sorts of environments like that. Trying to get the best balance between the various compromises that are inevitable in this kind of work. There are a set of tools which are now in Debian and stable on testing. And I'll go through those, how they work, how you use them for preparing your own packages and preparing packages for MDebian itself, or for MDebian users, so they can simply bootstrap, install, and keep their own systems up to date with apt-get and depackage and aptitude or whatever they want to use. Simple, normal Debian tools, simple, the intuitive way of handling a Debian system. And we cover the sort of developments that are needed for the future and how you can get involved. So that's what we're really about. We are a sub-project of Debian. We're part of the Debian family. Not all MDebian developers are Debian developers, but there's big overlap there. There's a lot of people with the Debian developer experience as well to help with the embedded work and to get the best compromise between the systems. The existing multi-architecture support in Debian is one of the things that Debian is famous for, all the different architectures we support. Now, that's very useful when you're working with an embedded situation, because often you're trying to work out how a particular package can be cross-compiled. And the configure script or something like that goes wrong and it tells you, oh, I can't work out, or I get the wrong value for a particular check. Well, you've got the build logs for the native package that we're still using, but we use the Debian source package as our source rather than going back to the upstream source. We're using Debian almost as our own upstream. So we've got the build logs for that package and we can use that. We'll talk later how to use that in a cache file we can pass to configure and say, look, don't bother trying to run this test. If it's, for example, a test that tries to compile some code during the build, and then run that code to get a value back from a library or some kind of environment variable or whatever. You can't do that when you cross-compile, you'll have the wrong file format. So you need to pass that value to the tools. And we do that by using the multi-architecture support in Debian to provide the data we need. And as to filling the gap between the iPack and the desktop. At the moment, a lot of embedded work stops at the level of iPack or something a bit more powerful than that. You need both sides. You need the mobile phones and beneath, and the same system that can scale right way up to the almost something powerful enough to run Debian itself. I'll let Wookie do the history because I've only been in this for a couple of months.
Hello, I'm only here for historical context. I just get to do this one slide, it's very exciting. And he's already said half of what I was going to say anyway. We started this a long time ago, 2000, Frank Smith Mavericks. And basically, we've been digging away at this complicated problem of what is the best way to make Debian smaller and generally applicable to small stuff. So, the summary, essentially, is we've tried this about six different ways so far. and for various reasons we've gone, nope, that's not really going to work. However, we do now have a fair amount of experience with what does and doesn't work. So we've had more or less two complete restarts. There was the original scheme, which kind of petered out in 2003-ish, partly because the kernel developers went a completely different way. And 2005, Philippe started off with a stag work, which is a fine example of how you can use apt and dpackage for cross-building. Ed Vartosh took that on to the stage concept, which is a way of making that more flexible. The Slimmed guys at Siemens have done very fine work on making UC libc work with Debian. And basically we're, after talking to some developers, particularly Julian Gilby, who has some fine input, we came up with yet another scheme, which is what Neil has been doing an excellent job implementing over the last few months. And that's pretty much working now. You can actually use it. Well, we have one package, GCC, which is called a major aggravation, and that will be fixed this week. So that's where we're at. Thanks.
Those are the important points that why we use Debian for MDebian. We want the main commercial and non-commercial distribution. We want the package management because it's well respected, it's robust, it's flexible. We want the multiple architecture support because we know that the package is built on that architecture, therefore if we get build problems, we know that they're cross-build problems, and we know where we can pitch the fix and the patch and both. And because of the huge number of packages, there isn't any point in going for this kind of scaled MDebian setup if we haven't got the number of packages behind us that are quality assured and we know we can actually use. The problems with using Debian is that Debian is all about native compilation. Cross-building has a bad reputation. A lot of perhaps the release managers, FTP masters, they don't want cross-build packages up in the Debian archives. There are various problems with doing that. So there is a challenge there in making cross-compilation for MDebian more palatable for Debian developers, making it easy for them to migrate from native development to cross-development. That's why it makes it so easy to use the existing tools. We're using CDBS, we're using DevHelper, we're using dpkg, apt-aptitude, all the other tools you would normally use. They're all there, they'll all work. But they just need sometimes little wrappers to help them work with the cross-compilation, and we'll be providing patches and helping the Debian developers make their packages more suitable for cross-building. Now, the trend in Debian is that disk space is cheap. In MDebian, space is a huge issue. We have to make sure that everything is as small as possible. Small is good, tiny is best. So we have to counter the general trend within Debian to make things with everything enabled, all the documentation available in the package. We have to work against that and be able to allow both packages to be built, but make a much smaller version that is suitable for an embedded device. There is some documentation you may need for an embedded device that can be done through context-sensitive help and stuff like that. You don't generally need the whole documentation that is in a desktop package because you can't view it easily on an embedded device. There are issues with optimizations. We've seen already that sometimes optimization can cause a very obtuse bug. It's very difficult to pin them down. So we're not changing optimizations as a matter of course at this stage. We might have to in due course, if that's going to be a problem, whether the bug is due to any kind of cross-compilation or some kind of optimization issue. Those kinds of issues need to be challenged and worked on. The software management is more or less covered by the tools. You shouldn't have too many problems with that, but you are going to have different dependencies on the MDebian package versus the original Debian package. The reason for that is to try and trim down the dependency tree, just strip out things that we don't need, and MDebian isn't going to use Perl as part of the essential packages. we're going to use a much smaller root FS so that the whole dependency issues have to be rejigged. And part of that is using other C libraries like UCLibC. Now, various ways we'll do that with separate repositories so that you can always have the UCLibC linked version, or you can have the glibc linked version, according to the power of your device and what you actually need. So what we've gone through, by combining SLint, Stag and Stage, and working with existing Debian developers, we've come up with this composite method. To make it familiar to Debian developers, we're reusing your existing package management system, all the tools are there, we're just trying to make them flexible with new packages. So we've got dpackage cross, which has been in the Debian archive for some time, apt-cross, which is new, which is just a version of app that goes and gets what you actually need to pass the dpackage cross. And then Debian tools, which is a tool set that does the wrapping of your normal build tools. So if you would normally use dbuild, well, there's mdbuild, which just does the few extra things you need to do for cross-compilation and has extra support. There are, if you would use dhmake, we have enmake. You still need to have a Debian package to start with, but then you run enmake to mdebianize it if you like to start the process of stripping things out. We definitely need to reduce all these package sizes. At the moment, the test packages we've built so far are about 68% smaller than they would be in Debian. Now that's good, we can do better than that. We need then to strip out some of the extra dependencies and all the documentation goes. Now documentation isn't just your doc package, it's your copyright, your changelog, your news, your readme, your to-do, your authors, all of that goes. UserShare doc, UserShare man, UserShare info will all be empty, because you're not going to have that sort of system on an embedded device. It consumes a huge amount of space. The translation files, with a small number of packages we've got at the moment, we've got a way of splitting out the translation files into dedicated packages. The downside with that is it doesn't scale particularly well, because you go from 80 source packages to something close to 1,000 binary packages. So there's almost a tenfold increase in the number of packages that would end up in the repository. That doesn't scale to Debian, so there are other ways of working around that, but at the moment we're happy with the small number of packages we've got to split out translation files as automatically generated packages of their own. You'll see later how that works. The changes we make to your Debian package, the source package, we keep in our own SVNs patches. You can see all the changes we make, and you can see what we've done. Changes would be to things like Debian control, Debian rules, and Debian Debian files in the Debian subdirectory, and Debian changelog, so we got our own versions of it. There's a new way of dealing with cross dependencies, which is Debian X control, which is something that came up in the Lucky Ideas bot, which we're building into in Debian tools. We're trying to be supportable that we'll have both installed on one system, subject to the various dependencies. So that's the main three packages you'd end up using. We will be built, or we have built, and we will continue building and updating binary tool chains for the various cross-compilation you need to do. We've got i386 and AMD64 built in regularly. We've got a little bit of an issue with PowerPC. If anybody's got a PowerPC that they can contribute as a build D for building tool chains, it'll take some of the load off my little laptop here that's struggling really hard. As the patches remove all the man pages, the copyright, the change log. They also remove all UDEB packages from Debian control. We're not dealing with a Debian installer issue here. We believe how to use a different kind of installer, and then we don't need those packages at all. AC try and other compile tests within configure. That's where the problems come in with build logs and actually providing a cached variable to cover the background to that. when we split up the translation files, then the user will need some way of picking up new translations. We have got a tool that will be in Debian only that will cover that, so that users will get the any new translation for packages they've already got installed. As I said, everything is controlled in a normal Debian directory. There's nothing extra going on. If we need, for any reason, to patch the actual upstream source, then we'll put that in Debian patches, and that patch will probably go back to you as with a user tag for a cross-built, saying, look, can you help us out here? This particular part of the upstream source doesn't work well in the cross-built. The build scripts from your Debian tools, it's all about applying the patches and then building the patch package, managing the patches as you change the files yourself, and keeping build logs as you go along. And then again, once the Debian tools are finished, it goes back to normal Debian tools, dpackage, apt, apt-to-do, whatever you want to use. And then the translation tool for the user is that final package there, line update. Simple thing, that just checks the list of supported locales set up on the device, looks for translations that match those locales, and says, look, you've got some new translations available for packages you've already got installed, and you save all the hassle of this slide. A lot of people make a lot of fuss about user shared dock. They get all this huge amount of space taken up by user shared dock. This is from my own laptop here, this, the PowerPC. I've got a fair number of development dock packages installed, but you can see there the user shared dock is only 250 megabyte, and that is optional stuff I've chosen to install in the most case. User shared locale, I don't have any choice about. Every time you install a package, it'll install whatever translations come with that package, whether you use them or not, whether they're even supported or not. A lot of the translations that are installed in your systems, you can't even use without doing reconfiguring locales. And each time you reconfigure locales, or each time you add a new locale, each apt-get upgrade you do that involves any kind of locale package takes longer and longer. So there are penalties to having more than you need set up for locales. On the first graph on the left, as you see it, the red slice is user share locale, the blue slice is user share dock. So even if you took out user share dock, you'd have a huge amount of space taken up by user share locale. The image on the right is a view of the disk space taken up by user share locale itself. And you can see that it's very, very evenly split up. Yes, some particular translations are more popular than others, so you'll have a slight amount of increase. But even the biggest individual translation directory there for French is only 9 megabyte, yet the entire directory takes 291. So you can see there, if you strip that out and you just have two or three locales configured, you've saved a huge amount of disk space. As a summary of how you would normally deal with a Debian package, you've got a source repository, you build the package, you upload it to a binary repository, you've got a local package cache. Now, the lines in red there are where you have problems with an embedded device. You can't build from the local package cache on your own system. You can't build to install on that device. So the cross-building scheme in many ways very, very similar. It's just that you don't have the option of building on the target device. Now, obviously, each Debian package, each Debian developer, you're all free to choose how you actually build your Debian rules and which methods you use. There's a lot of negative talk about CDBS. A lot of particular developers don't like it. Perhaps it hides too much from you. But in terms of cross-building, CDBS is the best thing around. It's very easy to cross-build, it does everything that you expect it to do. All we need to do is supply a replacement makefile for where CDBS would use DevHelper, we use mDevHelper and Makefile. It just omits certain parts of the build process. It stops the man pages being installed, stops the change logs being installed, all that kind of stuff on there. Obviously, those kinds of changes, you can't implement those in your own packages because they would break policy and Linden would complain. But in terms of mDebian, that's what we need to do. DevHelper, you start to get into issues. It is quite easy to patch DevHelper and stop these things being built, but a lot of packages don't confine themselves to only DevHelper rules. There's a lot of packages that will combine DevHelper with other methods like depackage calls directly or install, copy, move. All of those things make cross-building that package difficult. So there are issues there where if you use, some would call them hacks, some would call them ways of working around limitations in DevHelper. But if you use those in your package, then you may need to wrap those in either dev build options or something else conditional, so that there are ways that they can be omitted or skipped, particularly if they relate to any kind of documentation or other examples and other sorts of tools that you might not actually need in the main package. So we process DevHelper scripts as much as we can automatically. We'll take out the rules that are obvious. We'll take out the stages that we can. But there's a fair bit of manual editing involved to actually mdebianize a DevHelper package. Yeah.
So have you come up with a standardized way of conditionalizing rules file for mdebian builds? Because if so, the notion of starting to submit some of those as diffs back to package maintainers might be...
That's on the cards. That is on the cards. The thing with dev build options is that it's not designed to break Debian policy. So if you put something in like no docs, well, it's not going to omit the changelog and the copyright notice because that would break policy. It's not going to omit the man page or the info page generally. So there do have to be other ways of handling those. What we're looking at the moment, just in the last couple of days, is a system of filtering things like that within dpackage itself. So the dpackage doesn't install those things. If we pass the right options to dpackage, it simply won't install change logs, man pages, info pages, or anything you use share doc, or anything you use share, and then we'll process your share locale as well. But that will be an optional thing within how we handle dpackage, both in installing and building packages. That's very early days yet.
I probably handed the microphone back too quickly, but let me make a suggestion.
Yeah.
There's certainly no problem with defining something like an mdebian tag, if
yeah.
you will, and then asking package maintainers to include a conditional that supports that in something like a source packages rules file.
Mm.
Because while I think you're right that sort of generally end user visible build options like NoDoc, you might not want to twist that into delivering policy non-compliant things. There's also no policy requirement that says the Debian source package can only be used for building Debian binary packages.
That's true.
And so I certainly personally would think it was a great idea if we had some sort of standard conditional, whether it's mdebian as a tag name or something else, I don't really care. But if we came up with a well-defined way of conditionalizing the source packages so that you didn't have to maintain a lot of the stuff forever in a separate archive, but in fact you could submit these as patches back to the package maintainers and then just build with that option all the time, I think something like that could be a very reasonable approach, and I would certainly encourage package maintainers to accept such devs.
I agree. There's a lot of packages where that would work. There are a lot of packages, particularly packages that you would tend to use for a rootfs and the actual installation process, that are already incredibly complicated. I'm thinking of GCC 4.2 or something like that, where if you add that kind of wrapper in, it can be even more complicated. But
sure.
There is a role. There is a role for the simple packages. Those that the ones that use CDBS, they'll usually cross-build first time. But then if you've got a simpler package with just some basic, almost template-like dev handle rules, yeah, that would be a good way to go as well.
We have had that in the past. In fact, Impetus Cross provides a generalized mechanism for setting environment variables. So, but what we kind of moved away from that for the time being to prove that this will all actually work. So the point about the current system with just a set of patches to the rules files is that we can just do that and show that this is all marvelous, at which point we can then go, look, isn't this great?
Yeah.
Now, we want you all to make these changes in your packages, and this is how to do it. So we've kind of put that to one side for the time being. But I agree, you're absolutely right. There has to be a standard mechanism.
Yeah, it's part of the way of persuading Debian developers that cross-building is something they actually want to support. If we go too early and say to maintain the book, here's a list of bugs, all tag cross-built, and please can you put all these patches in, then a lot of them are going to just get left. So if we can persuade them and show everybody, look, this is really working, this is what it can do, then we work on from there. That shows you how the version string changes. The version string is critical in keeping all the various build files and the devs separate from your normal Debian builds for the mdebian builds. It's just a simple suffix that is incremented as we make new mdebian releases and is reversed to one when you make a new release yourself. So that's where the patch comes for Debian changelog. Even though we don't actually use the changelog and changelog doesn't get installed, we still need to patch it just with a simple automated few lines to enable the version number to keep your packages distinct as you build. And then at the end, what the wrapper tools do is they simply call dpackage build package with the aarch option. So the package is built entirely as normal. It's all down to the changes in the rules file and the controls. Yes. You've got dpackage cross installed. This is a dependency of mdebian tools, and that provides a diversion to the dpackage cross version that understands the A switch and understands what to do. As far as actually using the tools, there's a small amount of setup involved in getting hold of the binary tool chains, making sure they're installed correctly, making sure that you've got some kind of all the various dependencies involved and available. So msetup is a simple thing. You don't even need to run once on each development system that tells you what it's going to do, and then just installs the mdebian repository in your app sources and gets the tool chain. It isn't really practical to upload the toolchain packages to Debian itself, so you have to have our own repository added to your sources. But that's the way that we do that. We do that automatically as you install in Debian tools. It goes along and adds the source to your list. The main way of running mdebian tools for building mdebian packages for our own users will be to use msource. It's a way of using apt-get source and applying patches before we actually go much further on from that. You can use apt-get source yourself and do all the work manually, but this is an automated way. It's an optional component within mdebian tools that does a lot of the work for you. It also creates records in our SVN if you've got access, or uses our existing patches if you're just using anonymous SVN. And then the actual build script is mdbuild, just a version of dbuild that understands the patches, understands how to create the build log and deal with the SVN. Again, if you've got SVN access, you can commit those modified patches and the build log back to our mdebian SVN to keep our records up to date. And you will then upload the as normal dot changes file. You can sign it, you can, at the moment we don't really enforce signing it, but you can sign it as well. And that's the summary of that workflow. So you can see that msetup is a one-off. If you want to use SVN, you go to msource. If you don't, you need to do apt-get source, and the mmake is the script that actually does the initial patching, the initial preparation of the patches, creates the safe directory of unchanged files so that we can generate the dips. If you've got a username, you can actually use the SVN for mdbuild, which is the build script, and there's an optional sign as well, and that's where you get the changes from there. The patches themselves are stored in a series of files in the top level source directory. That's where you would normally find the built package, the built .dev itself. So above your above the Debian directory, above the actual package and version directory. And that's just listing what the various files will do. You've got the four main files. MDebian Controlling is only made if you're actually using a Controlling yourself. And at the bottom there, the MDebian file patch, if you've got other changes that need to be made, perhaps to your .install files, or perhaps other changes to other files in Debian, then MDBuild would notice that, will pick up that change automatically and generate a patch so that we know what's been removed from the other files in the Debian directory. Yeah, if you also create a new patch for Debian patches, we'd encourage, if the package doesn't already support dpatch, or if it uses CDBS but doesn't use the simple patch system that CDBS allows, then we'd encourage that to be added in, and then you just add a new patch if you need to. Not many packages so far. We've built 85 source packages, and only had to generate two or three source patches for Debian patches, and those are then committed upstream as opposed with the tag crossbuild. And again, it's not something we would ever make release critical or anything, it's just a normal or minor bug with the crossbuild tag saying, look, can you help us out and get that fixed? Well, two have actually been built, been done that way so far. Now this is where the Debian developers themselves come in. These are the problems we come across so far in packages we've built. If you use configure, please make sure that at least you've got the build and host options available to dpackage architecture to get the right variable that we pass via mdbuild and pass it to configure. That way configure will understand that it's cross-compiling. If you don't have build and host in your conf flags, then we will have to add it for you to get it to cross-build, and you'll end up with, eventually you'll end up with a bug report from us. But if you get a chance, if you're using configure in any of your packages, just make sure that the build and host options are specified. On the MDebian wiki, there's the exact actual lines you would need to add to call dpackage architecture and get the values you need to pass into those options. Now, the dev build option that BDL was talking about earlier, no docs, no check. No check is particularly useful. Remember that with cross-compiling, you cannot run what you've just compiled on that system. So you have to make sure that things like make check, if make check is entirely architecture independent, then fine, but we don't really need to build and check during the run anyway, because that would have been done on the Debian source. We could do it, but in general, most make check runs would use some kind of compiled architecture dependent routine somewhere along the line, and that will break. So if you use a make check, then please wrap it in the no check dev build option so that we know, we can skip it easily. The other problem is, we came across this with one package already. It builds fine, and you'll get messages that say, yes, build once, build twice as a Debian package. When you try to cross-build it, some packages are not idempotent in terms of their built files, the built sources. There's a package or a file that is built, generated from the source, but then it gets cleaned away, and it can't then be regenerated by the cross-build. It's obviously a bug in the package, but it is something that we've come across so far. And again, any kind of compiled code, anywhere in the build, for any reason whatsoever, we need to have either a way of skipping it entirely, or providing the value that it's trying to obtain and pass that in, so we don't need to get that variable. Yeah.
So there are going to be some programs where that's not going to be possible. Suppose you wanted an embedded version of NetHack. You really have to build the special level compiler with the host compiler. Is there any ability to use the host compiler at all?
You would have to have some kind of emulation. You would either have it, if you can't build that package, you'd have to have some kind of native run, wouldn't you? Unless you can run that script using the build architecture and get the values you need via that way. This is the problem we're currently having with GCC. It gets confused about what is the build, what's the host, what's the target. Generally we're talking about the build machine is the PowerPC or the AMD64 i386. We want the host to be ARM generally, or one of the other embedded architectures, and we want the target to also be ARM. Now, if your package can support that kind of thing, it can actually build on one architecture for another, then that's fine. With the host and the target the right way around. But if not, then that package in particular, is that going to actually be useful to an embedded device at runtime, install time?
It was just an example.
Right. But there may well be packages like that, but we either have to find some way of working around.
You can fix that by making a package for the build machine, which does the job, and so in a native package which is used at build time. That's the way this is dealt with in OE, for example. And yeah, I think we'll probably end up having to do some of that for fancier things.
Those are the simple changes we end up making to your Debian source package. It's essentially the same, but lots more. Right. And the version string. There are issues around your priority settings, because we're probably not going to stick with your existing priority settings. What Debian defines as essential is by no means essential to mDebian. Perl is a classic example in that setting. So in order not to generate false warnings with apt and dpackage later on, you may well have to modify your priority settings and downgrade them from required or essential or important down to optional virtually everything. The reason that we have to run these wrapper scripts is because of the problems with Debian rules and Debian control. We have to run and patch those before we can start running dpackage. We can't put a lot of these changes into dpackage or into deb helper directly. We have to wrap the process in other scripts, run the patches first, then run dpackage with the modified files. What we've got left to do in many ways is make sure that these tool chain updates happen as smoothly as possible. It's very difficult because what we found with GCC 4.2 was that it spent quite a significant amount of time after Edge was released when it wouldn't cross-build. It wouldn't build on ARM for a little while at all, even natively. So there are periods when we have these problems where the tool chain is very difficult to keep up to date with Debian and stable. Doing those transitions is so awkward time. We need to try and work out whether there is a way of maintaining an installable toolchain during a transition in GCC itself. My main emphasis on the main test environment for Debian tools and Debian packages is GPE. That's an embedded environment for IPACs. But it's a good starter for the rest of us, for the packages. Getting more packages built with MDBuild, getting more of these cache files and build log variables built into the patches. We've got a chroot builder as well now, along the lines of pdbuild, which will allow you to build a package within the CH route as a cross-build. That's very useful because it means you don't have to install not only all the dependencies of your nice GUI package, but cross-built versions of all those dependencies as well on your build system. The CH route will take care of that all for you. And we're now starting to use EDOS DevCheck to make sure that the packages we upload are actually installable from the packages file. The CH route uses pbuilder code, uses dbootstrap with some modified distribution files so that we only use the files that we absolutely have to. It builds an environment that is suitable for cross-building, so it builds all of Endebian tools into it. So it's quite, initially it looks a bit of a larger thing because you've got to have Perl in this particular CH root, but it's not in a CH root you can install, this is the CH root to build. And then we use Debian X control, a new control file in the Debian subdirectory that specifies what dependencies we need to have available to the cross compiler during the build. So these are the libraries that are going to be linked against your package during the build, and they're actually going to be installed alongside the package for it to run runtime. You've got to separate out your build depends now. You want the build depends for actually running the build itself, so that's things like dev helper, CDBS, autoconf, automake. But then you want the cross depends, which you will need to have available to the cross compiler. And those would be things like the libraries, the dev packages that you might bring in, whether it's X11 or something, whatever else you need to use, GTK, glib, that kind of thing will need to be installed as a build cross depends. The advantage, as I said, with the CH root, you separate all these dev packages away from your normal build machine. You don't need to have hundreds and hundreds of cross-built dev packages installed on your main machine. One of the things we have been able to do is also build a testing CH root. Dbootstrap does that quite easily. It gives us the advantage that we do have a usable tool chain to at least carry on testing builds, even if we're not building against unstable. We're building against testing just until we can get a new toolchain available. There's a lot of work still to do. So if you want to help out, there's lots of us here in the room already anyway, but join the mailing list, join us on IRC and on the website. Part of the work is convincing other Debian developers to support cross-compilation. That's where we got to at the start, where we need to show that something really is working. Then we'll get more Debian developers on site, and then we'll get more developers behind us and carry on testing and improve the documentation. There we go.
Has there been any interest in the Endebian community for building for the DSP platforms? Like, I guess there's SoftDA Linux and Jamuna, which is one of the DSP platforms, one of our devices.
At the moment we're restricting ourselves to supporting architectures that Debian already supports because of the close ties and when we're doing everything. You know, it's got to have prepackaged support and so on. So right now, anything even remotely exotic isn't supported. However, Slimd, for example, does support a whole pile of architectures that Debian doesn't support by making depackage changes and so on. So I'm sure we can move to supporting more architectures in due course. And it's mostly a matter of depackage support. But right now, no, we're restricting ourselves to this simple set of things. And there's a whole load of debate about exactly how you manage variants. You know, similar things which would count to one Debian architecture, maybe you want to build it 12 different ways. And we'd like to make that at least possible, if not easy. But that's not really something we have to worry about today. So,
do you have any jlibc ports or is it all uslibc?
At the moment it's all glibc.
Okay.
Uslibc has only really become usable in the last couple of weeks. and we'll be setting up separate repositories for the UCLibc linked packages.
Okay, will that be your new architecture? Or how will you handle having JLibc and UCLibc packages?
We've been having this discussion on the mailing list. There's two ways of doing this. You can, it is possible, as of last week, to install UCLibc and JLibc at the same time and just build against one of the other with the same toolchain. Or you can say, well, okay, that's very cool, but it's a completely stupid thing to do. if you only ever want, really want to use all UCLibc or all JLibc, so we should make them separate architectures. And you know, there's a whole load of questions about overloading architecture to now mean different API variants which are actually compatible. That's how Slim did it, you know, maybe 2 years ago now. It works fine. So we want to have a debate this very week. There's a guy called Ron Farrow who's trying to make it all work, and he wants an answer from DevConf on how we're going to do it. I think the MDebian bot is probably the best place to talk about that. So anyone who cares, please come along and have an opinion. Especially if you actually know anything about it, which is important.
You talk a lot about building stuff, but yeah. Are you actually using these packages that you build, or can you say something about what is this actually usable already?
Almost.
Okay.
This is what we talked about earlier. There is a particular problem with GCC 4.2, and it goes back to the build, host, and target confusion that happens within the Debian build, which doesn't seem to happen upstream. So there is a particular package that we're missing at the moment that we wouldn't normally need for a root FS. And we can work around that. We don't want to long term, we won't be able to fix GCCs, it will sensibly cross build. GCC will cross build in terms of making a cross compiler, but we're trying to prepare packages from GCC that will actually be installed on the host device. So it's actually more like a Canadian cross. But yes, just in the last 2 or 3 weeks, that CH root work has been extended to include a sandbox which uses dbootstrap and the foreign switch to create a CH root that is ARM compatible. So you then install the MDebian packages into that on an ARM device. And that, as of last week, that was almost working. And I've got a couple of changes to make in BusyBox. But yes, it's almost there.
So yeah, we fully expect to actually have a working rootFS that all came out of the tool and wasn't hacked or bodged this week. We're not annoyed, it's not working.
Yeah.
So sort of in the same context as the question about the JLibc versus UCLibc stuff, I'm actually, most of the embedded things I end up doing are on really small devices that probably will never run in Debian, and yet it would be very cool to at least be in another room where you're sharing and enjoying the same cross-built toolchain things and so forth. Have you guys spend any time thinking about people who are going to be using their cross-compiler and their other stuff with, say, JTAG on the targets that are not going to actually be running Debian packages, and to what extent is that sort of factored into how those things get configured, documented, delivered, etc.?
We're trying to support as much as we can. If we can support the smallest possible device, then we will go that way. It all depends on whether you can get a small enough system. We've got the rootFS down to under 15 meg already. We'll hopefully get it much less than 5.
So, yeah, I mean, you're right. A lot of people want to do that. And there is a trade-off between, we don't want to reproduce build root. The normal build root works. It's even quite easy to drive. There is a minimum size of machine for which shrunk Debian package and still including all that infrastructure about menu systems and stuff actually makes sense. You're just talking about using the toolchains.
Yes,
the toolchains are there, please use them. And it can now support UCLibc as well as GLibc, just a little bit of 30. Those toolchains are widely used already because they've been around for like 3 years. Quite a lot of people use them all the time for such things.
You've been mentioning convincing package maintainers to make their packages cross-building compliant. it seems to me that there are two separate things. One is making them cross-compilable, and one is making them embedded friendly in the sense of removing the user share lock and so on. It seems to me that making a package cross-compilable without necessarily removing user share lock and so on is a lot easier and,
yes,
and probably easier to convince people to do.
Yes.
I've been in my own packages.
Yeah, part of the work is what I've been looking at today, which is filtering within dpackage, so that things like user share doc don't have to be the concern of the Debian developer themselves or the package. We'll take care of all that. But the simple things like making sure that configure supports build and host, making sure that your cross build is idempotent, making sure that you don't try and run things that are going to be compiled in the host architecture. All those kind of things, that's what we would like the Debian developers to implement in their own packages. And then we'll take it on from there, making it into an end Debian package. But as long as the underlying package has things like that built in, and with some kind of understanding in the background of what cross-compiling really needs, and the kind of checks you need to make, just so you go through rules thinking, oh, hang on, where's that file coming from, and why do I really need to run that file, can I provide the value in some other way?
Just to say, it sounds right. Cross-compiling and Debianizing are in fact entirely separate. We've carefully conflated them in a confusing fashion here. It is possible to use the existing tools natively and avoid the whole cross-compiling thing. You can just see if it works. You can just in Debianize things, you can build natively and see if it works. We haven't really emphasized that because that's mostly not what people are doing. But I did do that on my machine and ran through a big pile of packages and quite a lot of them built. What we now really need is some web stuff, so you can actually get an easy list of how much stuff is still broken natively and how much of it is only broken because of crossness. But certainly, I think it's important to try and get Debian, to everything Debian to cross-built that can be made to one way or another. Yeah. But, and that is not fundamentally our problem, but we've kind of taken it on.
So my question kind of builds on that, because what would really be neat is to have some way of doing automated testing and QA. So my question is really, what are best practices for target emulation? Do you use, can you use things like Xen or QEMU, and is there sort of a target emulator for ARM or other competitive architectures?
As far as the cross-compiling support goes, as Wookie says, you can test it natively. You don't necessarily need to make sure that you run on an embedded device. As long as the support is there, then that's half the battle. But yeah, Wookie, do you want to take on the...
I think probably let's talk to someone like Aurelien actually about the right answer to that question. And yes, I'm sure you can use QEMU and stuff. I'm not learning here. Who is?
5 minutes later.
We don't know is the answer.
I assume you're using BusyBox inside of Debian, and I'm just wondering what you've done about the problem of all the Debian packages that use new extensions to different utilities, so BusyBox version doesn't work and that kind of thing. If you have any information to deal with that.
It's early days on that. The one problem we had with the rootfs at the moment is that although I've built BusyBox, BusyBox wouldn't complete the dbootstrap installation because I hadn't migrated the BusyBox UDEV configuration into our Debian BusyBox configuration. So it was a default Debian BusyBox, which obviously doesn't do a lot of the critical things that you would need to do if nothing else is installed. So that's part of the next build of BusyBox, is trying to solve those kind of problems. Once I've just need testing on the actual devices and trying to see what else we actually need to add to the BusyBox support. There will be issues later on with packages that perhaps don't build and don't run with that, but we know that GPE and its libraries and its applications, they do run with BusyBox because that is actually what GPE does. That's what GPE actually installs. So within what we're doing now, BusyBox is a good solution. We can always then replace BusyBox as we go on from there.
I guess correct something in front is you're trying to allow any Debian package to be put into the Debian system to be used. But we don't have a general solution to this problem. The package can depend on all these behaviors.
Yeah.
You don't have them, so I don't know.
Busybox is only really going to be essential for the rootfs and the initial installation. You can replace it after that before you add these complicated packages or the packages that expect new extensions. So we could even make two different or many different install images, one of which is the Busybox based one, one of which is almost a full Debian installer based that uses doesn't use the Busybox at all but uses the full depackage and app and aptitude and everything else that goes with it. Core utils and all that. It all depends on the device you're trying to support, how much space it's got.
Yeah, I mean, in fact, this concept I think really is to have a Busybox based Debian and a standard, totally Debian and Debian. I'm quite sure how we manage that. I think just two repositories is the easiest way to do it. But I mean, I don't know whether there's any appetite in Debian generally for making Busybox a sufficient root file system. I suspect it's not that big a deal, actually. I don't know how much. Yeah, you're certainly have more experience with this than I do. How many things break?
Could we just let everyone to do it?
Right, if you just look at, say, the base system, just Debian base, then you replace all the Busybox, or all the, you use Busybox for everything that's capable of doing. You'll run into things like suspended scripts that depend on a certain behavior or knowledge, or, you know, just various things like that. It's not really a huge amount of space system.
Is it like the using bashes?
Yeah, it's basically like that, except that there's no, you know, there's no standard here for a lot of it.
Yeah.
And then so
we've got the open embedded patches and files that work with that. So if there are changes, we can use their work to help us. We've done that already a lot with taking a lot of their patches to help us get some of our packages to successfully cross compile. We get in there, don't we?
In the target root file system, you said it's 15 megabytes now. How much of that is taken up by Debian package management? And can that be removed by a script
before we actually
start? That rootfs was actually just using Busybox to replace dpackage. And the biggest part of that was glibc. I'm looking at splitting out the locale support from glibc, which is a very big component of that binary mass, and getting down closer to 5 megabytes of glibc, and down to a level 2.5 for uclibc or even Verve. So the options are there.